and welcome to The Future Report, a podcast hosted by social research company McCrindle for anyone curious about the future. My name is Ashley Fell, and each week I'll be sitting down with a guest to discuss a topic or trend that you need to know about. Hello and welcome to our special Christmas episode of the Future Report podcast. Today's episode is also a really special episode because it's our final episode of season one. So a big thank you to all of our listeners who've come on this journey with us as we've launched this podcast. We were reflecting on it and it's been such a fun journey, and we're already planning season two. So we're super pumped about all of that. But in today's episode, as everyone can tell, we're talking about the festive season, which is often filled with friends and family and food and fun. And so we're going to reflect on some really interesting research findings that we've conducted over the last few years. And we're going to talk about the best and the worst Christmas gift givers, according to the people that we surveyed, how younger generations plan on celebrating this Christmas with some unconventional Christmas celebrations. We're also going to talk about consumerism at Christmas time and the need for community, and also the need just to be aware that not everyone finds it to be as maybe a joyful season as perhaps some others of us do. So joining me today on the podcast is McCrindle's Managing Director and my fellow Christmas lover, Sophie Renton. Hey, Soph, welcome back to the Future Report podcast for our special Christmas episode.
Thanks so much, Ash. I am absolutely delighted to be here to discuss some of the Christmas trends, one of my favorite topics.
Yeah, it's both of us. We love it. And we've both got our respective studios decked out with beautiful Christmas lights and trees. And we've both got our gingerbread lattes that we've talked about before on the podcast. They've made an appearance in the flesh. So we are set and ready to go. So let's launch in. But before we talk about the research, I thought we could both just share a little bit about our own experience with Christmas. So on behalf of Soph and I, for all our listeners, we are both avid Christmas lovers. Soph, do you have a favorite Christmas memory that, you know, fills you with joy and fun around this time of year?
Yeah, well, I think family is so important to me, and especially around Christmas time. So one of my favorite memories does link in with my family. And as I reflect, as I've got older, it was actually a very intelligent thing that my parents did for Christmas to avoid children coming down at 4 a.m. My mum used to play the piano at whatever time it was in the morning. And that was actually our kind of permission to be able to come downstairs. So we used to wake up on Christmas morning to mum playing the piano, and then we could rush downstairs and come and open up our presents. And then my dad was actually very creative and even did a scavenger hunt sometimes. So we actually had to work to get our presents. So it made the time extend, and we actually would watch each other unwrap it. And even with my brothers, sometimes we'd have to decrypt the clue together to be able to go and find the Christmas present, and the next person couldn't start until the previous person had found theirs. So I was like, very intelligent. They created a bit of like teamwork, a bit of fun, and some beautiful memories of my family at that time. What about your favorite Christmas memory, Ash?
Mine, I think, would have to be, I've got so many fond memories of just this time of year with family. But a couple of years ago, as you know, Soph, my husband and I had the real privilege of actually heading to Europe for a kind of a white Christmas. And because I love Christmas so much, and my husband's very gracious with me in that love, we traipsed around all the different Christmas markets across Europe. So we went to really amazing places like Strasbourg in France, and Salzburg in Austria, and, you know, German Christmas markets. And there was just nothing like being in that atmosphere of all the Christmas movies that we watch in Australia, where it's like a white Christmas and it's cold. And that was kind of where my kind of love of gingerbread lattes comes from. And, you know, I'm like, yeah, I love coffee, and I feel like I'm a little bit of a coffee snob. But then when it comes to gingerbread lattes, I'm like, oh, they're just the sweetest drink ever, like almost too sweet. And I have to manage people's expectations when I'm like, I just love this because it transports me back to that beautiful Christmas place. But I will say, as thankful as we are to have had that trip, and it was incredible, Michael and I really missed our families. Like on Christmas Day, it was just the two of us, which was really special and beautiful. But we like went out for dinner in Austria, just to a restaurant. And I'm like, normally we're trying to see all our family members and see the nieces and nephews. And so it was different, and it was incredible. But yeah, there's nothing like, I think, being with family at Christmas, as chaotic and crazy as it can be for some families. So that was pretty cool. But yours sounds really great because, yeah, your parents, I think, like you said, very strategic, intelligent decision to have sort of that signal of when you can start. And also a great way, I think, to make the opening of presents a bit more meaningful rather than just if there's heaps of presents, you know, under the tree, kids are just like, next, next, next. Whereas it's like, let's appreciate each gift and then we'll have to wait to the next one. So, you know, cheers to your parents for that. Maybe some ideas for other parents listening to the podcast.
Yeah, definitely. And I think it was always really fun working with my brothers on that. And I'm sure I'm the youngest, so they had to work on their patience with me as I had to decrypt my clues, and they always got theirs a whole lot faster than me. So
yeah. Oh, it's fun with siblings and kids at Christmas. And what about your favorite Christmas movie, Soph? Again, we talk a fair bit, you know, outside of obviously the podcast, in our personal lives, about Christmas movies and our love of it. Do you have a favorite Christmas movie?
I have a couple of favorites. I'm going to put them both in there. Probably one of my childhood favorites is Home Alone, the first one. You just cannot go wrong with that movie. But probably my adult favorite is The Holiday. I love that movie. It just makes all the Christmas vibes come alive. And similar to you, I love European countryside. So just being able to see the scenery of that movie makes my heart very happy.
Yeah. Yeah. Mine is probably like, just the really uncomplicated answer is The Holiday. Same. I love the English countryside, you know, at Christmas time. It's beautiful. And it's a really fun movie. And it's got an amazing soundtrack. Just hot tip is I always listen to it, like even outside of Christmas time, but even when I'm working, because it's kind of that orchestral Hans Zimmer. Anyway, but another one I wanted to sort of raise was, in my personal opinion, a very underrated Christmas movie. I only watched it the other day, is Christmas with the Cranks. It's so funny. I feel like not many people like it. But anyway, I think it's hilarious with Tim Allen and they're trying to boycott Christmas. So anyway, have you seen it?
I was going to say confession. I've actually never seen that movie. I've seen so many Christmas movies, but not that one. So maybe I will have to watch it in the next few days before Christmas.
Yeah, it's very good. And I also, special shout out to The Grinch. That was one that I, you know, watched growing up with Jim Carrey. And I think it's hilarious. We always, like, my husband and I often put it on when we're like putting up the Christmas tree, because it's just something you kind of have in the background. So anyway, all right, let's dig into some of these research findings, because they're super interesting around, you know, who Australians and people that we've surveyed think give the best presents, give the worst presents. So let's start there. The best gift givers, according to our survey that we conducted a couple of years ago, granted a couple of years old data, is number one, a spouse or partner. That is apparently the people who give the best gifts, followed by mum and then followed by dad. But I should say, actually, 28% said spouse or partner. Actually tied, 28% also said mum. And then number three is dad. But dad, only 6% said dad. So sorry to the dads out there. But what are your reflections on those best gift givers, Soph?
I think that shows that dads have some room to improve on their gift-giving abilities. But we all know that mums are the greatest. Mums pay attention to the little things, as do spouses and partners. And I think it's really the thoughtfulness of a gift that makes it go a long way. It's not necessarily about how much money has been spent or how extravagant it is, but is this gift actually personal to me? And is it actually what I need or what puts a smile on my face right now? And I think mums are fantastic at that, as well as our spouses and our partners. But good job, Dad, that you made it at least into the best Christmas gift list. The worst Christmas gifters that the study showed was actually the extended family is the worst givers, alongside our work colleagues and then our boss. But Ash, as our listeners may know, that we have a very good friendship outside of this. So you may be a work colleague, but you are also a friend. And I can vouch that you do buy great gifts. So you do not fit into that category of the work colleagues right there.
Oh, thanks, Soph. Yeah, it's funny when you look at that, you're like, oh, okay, work colleagues and boss, cool. But you're kind of, I mean, you have a really amazing role here at McCrindle as a managing director. So you are a leader in this business, and you often, I believe, maybe not, you know, you just keep it on the DL and the down low, but you are often orchestrating the Christmas gifts for the team. And I can also vouch for your ability to give gifts that it is, yeah, you don't fit into the worst gift givers. You're definitely in one of the best. And our team were even reflecting in the office like yesterday that the last Christmas that we celebrated, so you know, from 2020 to 2021, each of us got given like this beautiful esky kind of for picnics. And yeah, we're all saying, wow, so if that was a bit of a premonition, because that's all many of us have been able to do in 2021 is go on picnics. So that was a very relevant, very great gift that we all received from you. So many thanks for that.
Oh, it's a pleasure. I do love a good picnic, and I love seeing on Instagram when our team post photos of their picnics, and I'm like, I see the gifts in the wild and I'm like, oh, yay, people love it. So I think it's finding gifts that are useful for people and maybe things that they wouldn't necessarily buy for themselves, but that they can use in their everyday life helps make a good gift.
Yeah. And like you said, you know, I think the best gift givers being our partners and our mums and also dads, like you said, scraping in the list, the top three there, you know, like you said, it is the gifts that mean a lot to us that show that people are listening, that they've given us some thought, that it's very personalized. Whereas I guess the worst gift givers being, yeah, extended family who maybe don't know you that well, or even work colleagues or bosses. It's kind of that generic gift. And even we were talking about our Kris Kringle that we're going to have coming up. And I was saying it's kind of hard sometimes to even have something that you think almost everyone is going to like, because it's going in the Kris Kringle. So, and we play the stealing game. So that's always fun. But yes, things that have a bit of thought always go a long way. And there's also some previous research that we've conducted that shows some of the worst present categories that people have said are fridge magnets, ornamental figures, handkerchiefs, soap packs, and how do you say that?
Potpourri? I
think. Yeah, let's go with that. Fall into the worst present categories. So yeah, hot off the press, even though it's research we conducted a couple of years ago, maybe avoid those gifts if you are trying to go for something a bit more personalized.
Yeah, I think if you've got to go generic, go on something that's useful, not on something that's tacky.
Yeah, that's a great tip. And again, our research from the previous years, we asked a question in a survey that we ran, which said, what is your most hoped for Christmas present this year? And that yielded some really interesting insights. So the number one like kind of area of gifts that people want is experiences, so tickets or vouchers, followed by technology. And then following that, we had clothing, shoes or accessories, food or beverages, books or magazines, and then a smaller percentage of respondents said homewares, home entertainment, health and beauty, jewelry. So yeah, it's kind of the experiences, the things that maybe create memories rather than just more stuff, which I think is hopefully, yeah, something that people can take away and implement as they buy some gifts leading up to this Christmas.
Yeah, definitely. The experiences has been a really fascinating one to watch that trend rise over time. And we've often talked about trends and counter trends on this podcast. And I think with the experiences, it's almost like we've been confined to our homes. We've been confined to the monotony of life. And so having these experiences as a gift gives us an opportunity to do something new or do something that we haven't done before. We've seen so many of those businesses rise that focus on that create those moments of memories, like what is it, the canvas and the wine one, or the I actually recently got given one about looking after pot plants, which I'm really excited for, to go and learn how to not kill my plants. And all those different experiences that can create opportunities to learn something and to interact with somebody else, like cooking classes or those kind of things, are a really great gift, because it's not just something that sits on the shelf or something that you look at once, but it's an experience and it's a memory and it's a moment in time that you get to spend with somebody else. And I think we've actually done some research this year that led into that and gave some more insight into that. Do you want to give us a bit of a rundown on that, Ash?
Yeah, so we had the privilege of doing some research for Adrenaline, and they provide sort of experiences that induce adrenaline, I guess, like skydiving and things like that. And they wanted to explore this concept around, I guess, especially in light of the context and the year that we've had around many of us, like you said, Soph, being confined to our homes and not being able to go out and create memories or experiences if we have been in lockdown. And so they wanted to sort of see, well, what sort of gifts are people wanting to receive? And they had a bit of a focus on the younger generation. So the research we conducted only a couple of weeks ago found that 84% of Australians are planning to celebrate differently, Christmas differently this year, and to embrace an unconventional Christmas, which was kind of the name of this study. So interestingly, instead of a traditional family lunch, many were looking to sort of maybe have an excuse to do some adrenaline-inducing sort of activities or those experience-based gifts, like you mentioned, and even young Aussies sort of embracing an usmas or like a friendsmas sort of trend, where 86% were opting to buy presents they can enjoy with their partner or with a significant other. So, yeah, younger generations especially going, I don't maybe necessarily want more stuff. Maybe I had too many of those, you know, Amazon deliveries during lockdown, and let's get out there. Let's make up for some maybe lost time and have some experiences. And even to the point where some of them are saying we're boycotting traditional, you know, family lunch maybe on Christmas Day in favor of, some experiences. But any reflections on those insights, Soph?
I think it's fascinating just to see that rise in the experience. And it's not surprising at all that people are wanting to do something that gets the heart rate up, to make something exciting to finish off the year. I think it's still doing it with people that they love is probably the key part to take away from this. If they are boycotting their Christmas Day experience, I expect that there would still be doing it with someone they care about or with a family member, and even keeping in mind that for a lot of people, they can't necessarily get to their family this year. They might get to some of them, but not all of them. You know, borders are starting to open, but it hasn't necessarily allowed everyone to be able to make those trips. So people, instead of maybe experiencing a subpar Christmas Day of what they would normally expect of the whole family gathered and the beautiful chaos that young kids can bring to the equation, they're going, instead of maybe not getting the full experience of that, let's just change it up and do something completely different this year and make the most of that opportunity.
Yeah, absolutely. And yeah, I mean, even for these younger generations, perhaps as well, they maybe live at home and they've seen their family more than any other year being at home. So that's kind of even that friendsmas where they're like, I want to maybe spend this time with friends, or maybe those who don't have much family. And yeah, I mean, that friendsmas thing, I feel like, and the usmas is a bit more of a millennial term. And I see it in the Instagram sort of world from my peers where it's kind of doing like a big, like, family lunch, but with your friends, with the Christmas carols on, the Spotify playlist and that sort of thing, which is just another reason Christmas provides those opportunities for us to gather and to connect with others. And again, just in light of the last 2 years, where for extended amounts of time, we weren't able to do that. We weren't able to see certain family members or friends. I think, this Christmas season is going to be much anticipated. And again, for you, Sophie, even we've talked about this, but even last year, you know, you were subject to a bit of lockdown in Christmas, and now you're like, just let me have a Christmas with my friends and family. So I'm hoping and praying that comes to fruition for you this Christmas. I'm very optimistic about that for you.
Honestly, I'm like, it can only go up from last year where I had to be in complete isolation on my own on Christmas Day. So as long as I get any time with family or friends, it'll be a beautiful Christmas. And I love how you brought in the friendsmas, because that's actually something that I've seen so many of my friends do, and I'm actually organizing it. I've put out the invite to about 30 of my friends, so it could be a bit crazy to cook a big long Christmas lunch for them, but we're doing that a couple of days after Christmas just to be able to take that time to sit around the table and to enjoy people's company, and not in a hurry, not in a rush, but to have those conversations and to reflect on the year and to really cherish the community that you have. Because I think we can so easily take for granted what we have, and Christmas is just that great time to pause and to go, actually, how do I invest into my family? How do I invest into my friends? And we've talked about COVID so much on this podcast because that has been the experience of this year. But we have seen people take that moment to pause and to reflect and to reprioritize their lives on the relationships that matter. And so I think this Christmas is really going to be a celebration of all those relationships that people have said, actually, I really value this, and I'm going to take the time to celebrate with those people this year.
Yeah, absolutely. And I guess that leads really well into even some research that we conducted, again, only just a couple of weeks ago, around Christmas in 2021, and in light of, like we've talked about, the context and the previous years, and for those of us like yourself, Soph, who have experienced the last Christmas in isolation, which can, I imagine, be tough for anyone, let alone, you know, someone like you, Soph, who just adores Christmas, you know, it is really an opportunity to do that. And we did find that in our research. So we found that 88% of Australians, you know, that we surveyed this year said they love spending quality time with their family at Christmas. And people are really looking forward to it. We also, you and I, when we were putting this survey together, we were hypothesizing that, and I thought I'd experienced this anecdotally, that I felt like in November, people, I just saw so many more Christmas lights and Christmas trees up, and, you know, I was there ready to have the gingerbread lattes like the first day they come out, because they're only available for like a limited time. And I was like, oh, other people are getting on the bandwagon of, you know, celebrating Christmas early. And I saw that again in like my social media feed, where people were like, yep, we don't normally put the tree out this early, but it's been a tough year and we need some joy and we need some fun around this time. And our survey found that 42%, so almost half of Australians, said they have already or plan on putting up Christmas decorations earlier than they have in previous years. So I think, yeah, we're primed, we're ready. Many of us are ready to have that season of celebration after, yeah, for many, what was quite a tough year.
Definitely. We've seen the lights up. We've seen people going and seeing the lights in their local community. 75% actually love going and seeing those Christmas lights in their local community. But I think what's really important to reflect on at this time is that while it is a time of joy and of celebration and a gathering of people, for 46%, that's almost half. Christmas is a really tough time for people. And that could be whether they're not able to join with their family, or maybe they are able to join with their family, but there might be tension or friction there. And so it is a time of joy, but it can also be a time of challenge. And I think it's really important for us to keep that in mind as we go into celebrating this time, that what can be beautiful for one person and a beautiful experience can be really challenging for another. And even this is probably one of my favorite stats that we tested in this survey, was I really wanted to understand whether people were thinking broader than their own family at this time. And we found that more than half of Australians actually intentionally invite those who don't have anyone at Christmas to join their family celebrations. And I think that is just the most beautiful story about Australian values and Australian spirit at this time, that we go, actually, I've got a beautiful family and I love this time, but actually I can just lift up my eyes and look around and actually see that maybe for someone else, they don't have their family around, or for maybe someone else, this time is challenging, but I've got a table, let me open and extend that and to share that so that people can enjoy those celebrations. And so I'd say that's a challenge to our listeners, to say, who can you invite to your Christmas celebration? Maybe you've got your family part in the morning, but then you could do something in the evening, which is just a little bit slower, a bit more chill, but you can bring people in to really build back into that community that we've seen so many people really value this year. So that's my challenge to our listeners today.
Yeah, I was exactly the same. And I remember when you and I were crafting this survey and we were like, we should test and just see, because we have that, you have that hypothesis, you know, I'm sure we all know people who have gone through something tragic in 2021 or around Christmas time. And so that makes Christmas a tough celebration. And it can be hard when everyone else is having fun and there's lots of joy. And if you've gone through something, or Christmas is a time that just reminds you of someone or something that you might not have or that you've lost, it can be really tough. And yeah, that was a sobering stat, that 46% said Christmas is a tough time for them. But exactly right. So it was also the encouraging sort of inverse of that Australians are keen, more than half are keen to open up their home. And that was a challenge to me as well, to think, well, like you said, who can I invite? Who can I reach out to? And we talked about the power of kindness in our previous episode with Steph Raisy on the podcast. And just, yeah, at this time, yeah, just to be aware that in the midst of the joy and the celebration, there are people who are hurting and there are people who need care and kindness. And yeah, Christmas should be a time of community. And so, like you said, Soph, I love that, in terms of opening your home, extending an invite to someone, you know, taking them a gingerbread latte, or just making them feel like they're included and they're loved and appreciated, can, yeah, have a really big impact, and we certainly don't ever want to undermine that aspect and the power that we have as individuals to have a positive impact on others. And I think something else I wanted to just get your insights on, Soph, another aspect of Christmas that is a little bit more serious and less fun is that idea of, I guess, consumerism. And we asked, you know, this, again, a similar question, or tested a statement in the most recent study where 80% of people we surveyed agree that Christmas has become too commercialized. And, you know, again, it's fun and there's lots of decorations up and we're encouraged to go and spend and buy gifts, and that can be a beautiful thing. But it can also be this time of just, yeah, increasing consumerism, where we kind of get more than we need or spend more than we have or go into debt. And I know, Soph, a couple of years back, you were involved in some really interesting research about consumerism in Australia. Any reflections on the challenge, that kind of that tension around consumerism at Christmas?
I think that word tension captures it perfectly, because for 71% of Australians, they actually agree that they own more than what they need. So largely we're going, you know what, I actually have everything that I need. And yes, this is a time of gift giving and a time of celebration, but I don't actually necessarily need anything more. But there is that tension. The 82% also feel good when they buy something new. And there is that, like, oh, yay, fun, or someone's given me something, and wow, thank you so much, that's so thoughtful. And that is the tension where we're going, actually, I've got everything that I need. But the beauty of gift giving and of those moments of celebration is so powerful, and it builds relationships and it builds community. And so there is this tension between the consumerism and the commercialism of Christmas, and then stripping back Christmas to some of what it is about, and those moments of celebration and of gathering together and being thankful for what we have. And it's interesting to watch this trend of consumerism. Similarly, at the same time that we're also seeing the rise of minimalism, I guess, and that desire for the simpler things in life. So there are almost these two opposites that are creating a tension against one another. But I was reading this book just on the weekend, and it was talking about how you don't get space in your life automatically. You get space by design. And I think that is something that when we think about even consumerism and gift giving, that we create room in our life by being intentional about what we purchase, about what we give, around actually being intentional about thinking, does someone actually need this? And I was reflecting with a friend the other day, we're talking about those Secret Santa games and the steal and swap ones. And, you know, they are really fun, but we're like, oh, I just really appreciate when someone buys a good gift and not just something that you'd get on unwrap and be like, I've got no use for this, and just have to put it in the bin or give it to Vinny's or Salvo's or whatever it is. But we are seeing people have that desire to see a shift and to not let things go to waste and to be intentional about what they have. So I think, yeah, that reflection is that the tension is of the consumerism and the desire for the simpler things in life at the same time. And so it's almost going, how do we at Christmas time not fall into that trap of consumerism? And I think some of that comes back to being really thoughtful and intentional about what we buy for the people in our world, and whether that is the experiences that isn't just more stuff, but is creates a moment and an opportunity to engage with people.
Yeah. And I love that reflection. And yeah, you're right. I think Christmas being a time where there's kind of that social norm, and it's expected that you buy gifts for everyone or whatever the arrangement is in your circle of friends or your family, versus buying something for someone because you know they're going to love it. Like, you know, we know the stress that comes, many of us, where you're like, okay, I've got a week left till Christmas and haven't got all my gifts yet for everyone. And then you kind of just forced into buying something that maybe you know they're not going to enjoy, but you just need to tick that box. So that's the challenge. But I mean, a thing that I found really helpful in my family with my with my husband's family and his siblings, because he comes from a relatively large family, is what we've done recently is Secret Santa. So we're not buying gifts for every single person. But there's this like thing called Elfster online, and you know, you register the people with an email address, and it automatically, you know, spits out who you need to buy for in a secret way. But then on that platform, like, you can go in and put, I would love to get this book or a voucher for this place. And so I found that really helpful, because then everybody is putting on something that they actually want or that they need. And so for me this year, I've got someone who I won't say in case they're listening right now, they've put on something they want to get. So what I've decided to do is because we've got a certain monetary amount, half the amount will be something that they want and the other half will be something that I think that they will want, because I know them very well. And so that's kind of like, they get something they said they want, but then also a little bit of a surprise, because there is something lovely about, like we shared, like you shared earlier. So, you know, someone going, I thought of you and I got this. It is the tension. But something else that was really interesting, and like you said, you know, when we get presents that we don't want or that we don't need, or we're trying to create a minimalist life, kind of plays into this, that 44% of Australians said they don't hesitate to re-gift presents that they don't like. I have done that before. I've re-gifted a present that I don't like. I won't say what the present was or who it was from, but, you know, it is that world where we go, oh, I don't need more stuff, or I don't have the room for this in my life. And so, yeah, to re-gift that on or to give that away is something people are doing. So that might just, yeah, require us to get a bit more creative in our thinking. And like we shared earlier, not go for the sort of ticker box things like the soap or the other like little knick-knacky things that maybe no one really needs.
Yeah, I think that is a great plan this Christmas. I'm trying to think right now, actually, if I've ever re-gifted something. I'm sure I probably have, but I can't think of anything off the top of my head. But yeah, it's taking the moments to think about who you've got and to be intentional with that gift, and showing that you've thought of them, I think, goes a long way with the Christmas presents this year.
Yeah, absolutely. And I just wanted to touch on two more stats from the research we conducted that I just found super interesting. So it was interesting for me to see that 81% of Australians said that they agree that they're supportive of the religious traditions and symbols of Christmas. So whatever that might be in terms of traditional Christian Christmas carols or nativity scenes that they see around. And then the other stat that I found that was also interesting, that I think that you and I put in, I mean, we sort of crafted this survey, or this question, was 75%. So 3 in 4 people love going to see the Christmas lights in my local community. And I am gladly one of those people. And I just shout out to anyone who does the community a service by, you know, putting up Christmas lights and footing maybe a more expensive Christmas bill, because it does, or electricity bill, I should say, because it does create, you know, a point of community to walk around the neighborhood and see Christmas lights. And I used to do that when I was little. We'd drive around and have a look, and I always have to, you know, say to my husband, let's go look at Christmas lights. And he, you know, obliges me that joy. So that was also just fun to see how many Australians are doing that. So yeah, if you are someone who does put up Christmas lights, thank you.
100%. Thank you. It puts a smile on my face every time I drive past and I can see that. And I think it does create that sense of community, because when you see those streets that draw everyone and everyone gets out and about, they put their Santa hat on or whatever, and it just creates that vibe and that conversation, and it brings the joy around that time of Christmas. And even what you pointed out before around the religious traditions and those symbols of Christmas, I think that's actually really encouraging, that for 81% of Australians that they're still supportive of that, that they are aware that Christmas came out of the Christian tradition, and they go, you know what, that's okay. Yeah, we've molded it and we've made it into what's reflective of our family values, but I'm still supportive of where it came from. And I think some of that becomes the traditions of the carols, and I love carols, and it's almost like, okay, we often send each other memes of maybe late October or early November, and it's like, are we allowed to listen to Christmas carols yet? But it is those traditional moments that people can lean into and embrace. And it's almost creates that point of the year that creates the whole feeling around the time when you've got those things that you only do at that certain point of the year. So, yes, love the Christmas carols and appreciate that Australians are still supportive of where Christmas came from.
Absolutely. Well, thank you so much for this chat today, Soph. It's been such a delight. We've gone a little bit more relaxed on the episode plan, but we could talk about Christmas for ages. But I love that we can bring in some insights and some research, some statistics to back up, you know, what maybe people are seeing in their community. And yeah, to talk about the joy and the fun and the festive nature of Christmas, but also just some stats there to shine a light on the fact that not everyone, it is a joyful time, and just for us to be aware and to exhibit kindness and show empathy. And like you said, open up our homes or our, you know, dinner tables to those who might be feeling isolated or lonely at Christmas. So such a lovely chat and a lovely way to end season one of the Future Report podcast. So thank you so much for the chat today, Soph. It's been amazing.
Thanks, Ash. I have loved being here.
And as I mentioned, that does bring us incredibly to the end of season one of the Future Report podcast. So a big thank you to the listeners who've come on this journey with us and to all of our guests who've been on the podcast, including yourself, Soph. And if you have enjoyed this season, we would love for you to leave us a review on Apple Podcasts. We know that reviews are pretty hard to come by these days, and so we greatly treasure them. And I do genuinely read every single review, so I really look forward to hearing what people think. And if you'd like to read up more on some of the Christmas trends and stats that we've shared today, you can just head to McCrindle.com and type in the search bar just Christmas, and that will bring up a lot of our previous research for you. And while this episode does bring us to the end of season one, we've already planned out some of the topics and research and guests, some exciting new guests that will be showcased in season two of the Future Report podcast. So I personally am super excited and looking forward to that. So once again, thank you for listening. Have a wonderful Christmas, and a very special shout out to the 294,583 little Gen Alphas who will be celebrating their first ever Christmas. And on behalf of the McCrindle team, we hope you have a safe and happy Christmas and New Year. And we look forward to sharing season two with you next year. So bye for now.